I guess this is proof positive to let you know that if you're going to beat back racism, the feds are not going to help you do it. And the civil rights laws in this country are not functional. They are not functional, and they are not meant to be functional. They've been functional in terms of creating a black middle class in this country, but they are not functional when it comes to beating back white supremacy, violent white racism. It's not, they're not functional for that. That requires a mass movement. And that's what we've been doing in the South. Ever since I got out of prison, almost from the first day I got out of prison, since first day I got out, I had to deal with the black community up in arms over the police murder of a black man in the city jail. And the daughter of this man formed an organization called the Concerned Citizens for Justice that I became involved with and ultimately became the president of. That organization ultimately became the Ad Hoc Coalition Against Racism and Police Brutality, a region-wide organization dealing with racist violence all over the South, of which there's still a substantial amount. You just know about the church burnings. There's been a hell of a lot of burnings of people's homes, activists particularly. There's been a hell of a lot of shootings of people. Like drive-by shootings, racist drive-by shootings that purportedly had stopped happening 30 years ago. The climate is beset, you know, with the economic inequality, the increase of that, with the building of prisons, with the limitless acts of police terrorism, all of these things are being allowed to happen by those in authority. And it's really important to understand that. That's why we can't get fooled by this thing about the good cops. The good cops. Well, the good cops are the ones letting the so-called bad cops do the dirt. Somebody said, well, we'll find a grave for them too. You know, some of millions of dead cops. But the conditions for this kind of terrorism and this racism is not an accident. It's not a result of somebody's bad thinking or some ideas in white folks' head or something like that. It's not a question of that, actually. This government is the criminal that allows this to go on. There's not going to be any reforms. One thing that was proven by the civil rights period and is being proven now, we're not going to get the kind of reforms to do away with racism under this system. It's not going to happen. This system has to be toppled, dismantled, and destroyed. And you know, somebody was saying, well, you know, in the book I wrote, friends of mine, I know they didn't want to get me hurt or nothing. Why did you put in that book that you wanted to see Tom Metzger shot? Well, I'll tell you why, you know. And it was provocative. It was meant to be provocative. At the time when I rewrote Anarchism and the Black Revolution in 1994, was a time when groups purporting to be the new Black Panther Party were meeting with Tom Metzger in Dallas, Texas. Had him as the guest of honor in Dallas, Texas. He gets up saying that I'm a white separatist, you're a black separatist, we can work together. That's impossible. That's the kind of contradiction in roles and terms that we're dealing with in the 1990s and beyond. That's the kind of sellouts that go on now. You know, that's the kind of misinformation and misunderstanding of who the actual enemy is. And that's the way you look at race and class issues, look at race issues, and don't make some sort of class analysis with it. Because if you look at this just in terms of the color of somebody's skin alone and not attach an understanding to that about the nature of the state, about the nature of capital, and how they use race as a divider and class as a divider and rule over all of us with an iron fist, unless you understand this, you will turn and attack the wrong folks. You'll think that the state's on your side or that the state's impartial or something other than the government isn't impartial. And my understanding of government and the state has nothing to do with protecting a so-called lifestyle. I'm not trying to protect my lifestyle. I'm trying to protect my damn life. And that's a big difference, you know, because the state is the biggest killer, biggest oppressor of all. I mean, throughout history, you know, this state has killed more people with wars and pogroms and mass murders and of one sort or another. You can just point to that at any time in history and you can see where these criminals have actually perpetrated their acts of violence. So from my standpoint, from the standpoint of how I see the world, and you know, the things I put in Anarchism and the Black Revolution, and I wrote that when I was in 1979 when I was in a control unit in Marion. I wrote it when I was in a control unit in Marion. And for those of you who don't know what a control unit prison is, it's a special high security unit. At that time, it was used also for behavior modification, forced drugging, and psychiatric tricks and methods of breaking your will, so-called brainwashing and all of that, to put it in a capsule. But in the time I went into the control unit in Marion, there had been 10 people killed in that unit, and numerous people driven insane or had their, you know, spirits broken and had to go into mental hospitals and so forth. Well, I was fortunate in one sense in that when I went in the unit, there had been years and years of struggles by prisoners to resist it. And we fought our way out of there. I was able to get my way out of there for sure. Through lawsuits and letters written, and then there was demonstrations around the prison, and I was fortunate to get out of there alive. A lot of people got killed in there. So I wrote Anarchism and the Black Revolution in there, one, to declare to the world that I was an anarchist, two, that in fact we have to deal with race and class issues in our movement, in the anarchist movement. We cannot, at that time, people pretended that there was no such thing as racism, you know, or it wasn't a big issue. I had a person tell me, oh, that isn't something we worry about. I said, I'm sure it isn't something you worry about since all of you are white, you know. I said, I'm sure it isn't something you worry about. But it's something they worry about in 1997, since the Klan has spread all over the United States and right-wing forces run the state and they're in power. They commit crimes and terrorism all over. It's something that you're going to worry about today. And as time goes by, it's something you're going to worry about more and more. You know, it's going to be, because we'll look up and we'll have an outright fascist dictatorship sitting over us if we don't do or say anything. And it's, you know, for people of color, you know, with one in every three young black male in their 20s in the penitentiary, or the so-called criminal justice system, one in, someone said, seven Latinos, according to the report by the Sentencing Commission, in the prison system. And more people in prison today than has ever been in prison anywhere in the world, and certainly anywhere in this country here. When you've got that many people that are in prison, the state has declared war on the youth. You have to understand that. The state has declared war on the youth, and especially the black youth. And it's to them, it's a national security matter, because they know that the youth can rise up, and if they were politically motivated, overthrow this system. They know this because they had the experience of the Black Panther Party of the 1960s. And regardless of whatever errors the Black Panther Party made, it proved decisively that the most despised sector of the working class, especially the black working class, the most despised sector, is capable of revolution, of becoming a motive force for revolution. And that was that gave the government fits. And it also demonstrated for the first time that it isn't just white workers or white people that had to lead everybody around by the nose, but that a autonomous black movement could change the face of this nation and could change history. Now, it can't do it necessarily all by itself, but the question of what is the agent for social change, the agent for revolutionary social change, it is a new day in the world. Capitalism itself is not even the same. What the hell? People think this is the 1930s and everybody's in fucking, you know, the big factories or something now? This is a post-industrial stage, people. You go in, ride around, look in the cities, and you see nothing but foundries and factories closed up. We are not in the same period as in the 1940s and 50s or 30s. We've got to come up with some new ideas. We've got to come up with some critical thinkers. If there's any one thing I've tried to be, it is to be a critical thinker, somebody who's not afraid to leap the bounds of the box, the ideological box. We need more people like that. I don't position myself as some sort of hero or leader or something or other. And I think that anyone is capable of intellectual and theoretical work. Somebody asked me this morning, well, do I have to be some sort of a revolutionary theoretician to be an anarchist, something like that? I might not be doing justice to what she asked me. But the point is that we have got to be able to explain our own ideas to the world. If you can't explain your own ideas to the world, except for those who are in your own box or tendency, then you're in bad shape, because we've got to reach so-called ordinary people and tell them about what anarchism is, what anarchism stands for, the kind of world we want. We have to be able to do that. So somebody asked me, what does it take to be an organizer? Somebody willing to get out in the streets and talk. You talk to each other all the time, but you talk to each other too much. You need to break out of the ghetto, break out of the anarchist ghetto, and get into the community. Okay. So from my standpoint, I would just say to you that, you know, it's really important that we make the ideas more than just a subculture. It has to be more than just a subculture. You know, I know people like punk rock and they like hip hop and so forth and so on. And, you know, the group I deal with, most of the people I work with are younger than I am, for damn sure, you know, my many years, they're younger than I am. And, you know, they got their cultural, the things they like and all that, but that won't make a revolution. I mean, that, if anything, the revolution does is it makes the culture widespread, not the other way around, you know. And we need to understand that. We need to understand that we've got to reach out to people if we want real social change. We can't make the mistake of sitting in, like people sit in church, and think everybody in the world is going to come to them. It's not going to happen. This ain't the anarchist church, you know. We can't let it be. And that's real, real important to understand. I live in an area where, in fact, how much time I got? Okay. So I live in an area where, in fact, you know, there are people who have a particular set of problems. But I don't, after having been here, I haven't seen anything that I didn't recognize, you know, and by that I mean, you've got the same set of problems. They may not be riding around, the Klan may not be strutting around in the community, you know, in a robe. Maybe they're wearing a blue suit, but they're the same, there's the same force. You've got a serious problem in the Bay Area with police brutality. I see all kinds of people rising up, I see movements developing. But what I don't see is, I see radicals or activists talking to each other. What I don't see is people in the community, reach into the community where these people are the actual victims. Malcolm X said, if you want action, I said, you gotta wake the people up. And I'll say, not only do you have to wake the people up, you gotta get over there and help them mobilize and build autonomous formations in their communities. Anarchism is not going to go by some wind or just some belief, or somebody's just gonna one day wake up and say, oh, I'm an anarchist. It's not gonna happen like that. You have to work, you have to talk to people, you have to, you know, spread ideas. That's what you have to do. And you can't be satisfied just to look around and see people look like you when there's a city which is diverse as this one is. I think that's a cop-out, I think that's a damn sellout. So I really think it's a responsibility on us to get up and do something about that. Thank you very much.